played a while, you realized that, you know, certain place is the right place for you. I didn't know it would last 20 years, but I knew that, you know, as long as I was playing, this was where I wanted to play.
Once in a while, there's a being who stands all alone, so far away from the crowd. Makes an impression like no other who has walked this earth, a soul embraced from all around. Of all the people I have seen in my inspired life, I wonder what it is that makes me idolize, what makes a legend exist eternally with time, a legend of radiating light. Is it something from above, or something from within, or is it something
everyone, this is Tony Gwynn, formerly of the San Diego Padres, now, as you can see from the new colors, volunteer coach at San Diego State. And for whatever reason, they want to cram 20 years of my career into about 5 or 6 minutes. So, Jeff, good luck.
The numbers alone guarantee Tony Gwynn's place among baseball's immortals. 3,141 hits.
Line drive, center field, there it is, number 3,000.
8 batting titles. 16 trips to the All-Star game.
Do it. Being waved, home is Gwynn. They got a play to Rodriguez. Safe. And the 6-game drought is over.
19 consecutive 300 seasons. A .338 lifetime batting average. And 5 Gold Glove Awards for defensive excellence.
That's a base hit at the right center. Alou's gonna try for third. Here's Gwynn's throw. He's out!
Yet all of these accomplishments during Tony's 20 unforgettable seasons as a Padre tell only part of the story. For 2 decades, he defined the Padres. From the day he broke into the major leagues as a rookie in 1982 to the glorious World Series season of 1984 and into the early 1990s when he stood as the lone constant for a then floundering franchise characterized by continuous change.
To the left side and through. Reed scores.
He was right in the middle of the Padres' revival, sparking a division champion in 1996 and a National League pennant winner in 1998 when he batted .500 in his second World Series. He was there every step of the way, and right through his final farewell in 2001, Tony Gwynn set the standard, one of the greatest hitters to ever play, one of the game's most astute students, and one of baseball's finest citizens. He made it look easy, all of those 200-hit seasons, 5 straight seasons topping .350 from 1993 to 97. At an age when most players hang it up, Tony Gwynn was better than ever.
5-hit game this year. Unbelievable.
No one worked harder. Early batting practice. Thousands of swings off the batting tee and in the cage. No one studied his craft like Tony, a pioneer in the use of baseball video and a player eager to learn from other greats of the game. Legends like Stan Musial, Hank Aaron, and Ted Williams.
And when you start to swing at the ball, what's the first move? Now, just think about it a minute.
I just think about seeing the ball come out of his hand.
Yeah, okay, that's good. That's
okay.
Good.
I'll give you the sequence. This is what, in my mind, this is what happens. Pitcher starts his windup. He gets to the release point. And once he gets to that point right there, now I'm going to start my cocking action. I'm going to start take my front foot forward.
When do you think your front foot hits the ground?
Early, for me.
How early?
Real early. Not too much longer after this, after he lets that ball go.
You're 100% right. Most guys are late doing that.
Yeah. Yeah.
In assessing Tony Gwynn's greatness, what truly set him apart from so many others was the impact Mr. Padre had on San Diego. While he lifted spirits with World Series home runs and game-winning hits, Tony's contributions extended well beyond the confines of the diamond. With his wife, Alicia, Tony gave his time and his money to help make America's finest city an even finer city.
From my standpoint and my family's standpoint, we're just doing what we, you know, is the right thing to do. You know, I mean, being in the big leagues, there's more to it than just playing baseball. There's more to it than just going out there and having success and, you know, getting accolades. It's about, you know, being involved in your community and trying to do your fair share.
For 20 seasons, Tony Gwynn did far more than his share. On the field and in the community, he was a hero to generations of San Diegans. And as Tony says goodbye, the images are embedded indelibly in our hearts and in our minds. The sweet swing, the love of the game, the consistent excellence, the unwavering dedication to his city and to his team. So while the numbers will undoubtedly make Tony Gwynn a Hall of Famer in 2007, it is so much more that will make him Mr. Padre forever.
Nice job, Giff. I didn't think it could be done, but you did a nice job. You know, people ask me all the time, what are my favorite moments? What moments in my career really stick out? Well, there were a few. I love, like, being on the mound with Ted Williams at the All-Star Game in 98.
Driven to right center. That's in the gap. Finley will score easily. Caminiti is getting the wave. Gagne's throw to the plate is cut, and it's a two-run double for Chris Gwynn, and the Padres have jumped on top 2-0.
You know, my brother getting a pinch hit that sends us to the playoffs. You know, being on the bench for that is a big thrill. Number two is probably my 3,000th hit.
Line drive, center field, there it is! Number 3,000 for Tony Gwynn! And his first at bat of the night in a foreign country in Canada. At Olympic Stadium, Tony Gwynn has done it.
You know, finally getting that done, you know, that whole chase was a lot of fun, but the relief you felt after you got it done makes that one stand up there. You know, number one is hitting the home run in Yankee Stadium. That's still a big thrill. First game playing in Yankee Stadium. I waited 18 years to get a chance to see it on the inside, and so hitting the home run in game one of the World Series is number one. The home run is set up really by the first at bat of the night. And Kilvio Varas is on first, and I believe the count's 1-1, and I put the hit and run on. We're playing hit and run. And David Wells throws me a breaking ball, and it's down, and it's out over the plate. And I was kind of fooled on it, but I kept my hands back nice and just kind of served it in the left field. And, you know, you see Jeter break in the cover second, and the ball's going right where he'd left from. And the thing that nobody saw was, or heard, was David Wells dropping bombs on me because I hit a breaking ball out over the plate. And so I knew from that point on he was coming in.
One on, two out. Tony Gwynn at the plate. Rip! At the bottom of the upper deck, and Tony Gwynn goes deep with his first postseason home run to put San Diego out in front 4-2.
And I had told Merv before the inning started that if he comes inside, I'm going to be ready for it. And he threw a slide step heater, and I was just on it. It was in and it was up, and I got my hands to it nice, and it went out of the ballpark. And the thrill of jogging around the bases and trying to keep a straight face You know, I don't think that thought for the fans sitting at home, I don't think that comes into your mind trying to keep a straight face, but I was trying to keep a straight face. And you high five, and heck, before I could sit down, Greg Vaughn goes deep. And it's the first game of the series, and you feel like you're in control. You got a 5-2 lead. You got the lead. You got quality pitcher on the mound, and you got a chance to go up 1-0. And unfortunately, it didn't work out that way. But for a bat, I don't know how long that took. 5 minutes, 10 minutes for that inning. I don't think I've been more excited about playing a game of baseball as I was in that 5 minute span. Well, those were some of my favorite moments. I probably have a whole lot more that I'd like to talk about, but this tape's only going to be, what, 30 minutes long, 40 minutes long, and that's plenty. And so now we come to the time in the show, once again, that, you know, I'm pretty much a straightforward guy, but some of these lines on this thing that they want me to read, like they want to call this next section the Tony Awards. Exactly. It's not very funny at all. And so here's the awards section. Well, I saw Henry play a lot growing up in LA, but it wasn't until I read the Total Baseball book. When you look at his numbers, who can argue? You know, all-time home run leader, up there in RBIs, up there in runs scored, 3,700 hits, you know, gold gloves, stole bases, you know, he did everything. So for my money, and it's hard because I've seen a lot of great players play, but it has to be Henry Aaron. I've said for years Barry Bonds is the most complete player that I played against. Larry Walker would be a close second, but he just does everything really well, you know, defends, once again, steals bases, hits for average, hits for power, drives in the big runs, gets the big hits. In my 20 years, he was about as good as I saw.
Unbelievable.
I still say Nolan Ryan / Randy Johnson. You know, Nolan from the right side, Randy from the left side. When they were on, you couldn't hit them. And, you know, those two guys probably struck me out more than anybody I faced. And it wasn't fun facing them either. But still, it was the best, you know. Atlanta, Fulton County, the old Fulton County was the launching pad. I love that place. And good hitter's ballpark, big, but it was a good hitter's ballpark. It was my favorite. So I was crushed when they knocked it down and built the Ted Turner's place. But Fulton County Stadium, that was my favorite place to hit. The first time you play at Wrigley, you think, oh, these fans are great. You know, you go out, you take batting practice. Hey, young fella, how you doing? Hey, good luck to you. Hope your career and blah, blah, blah. And come game time, boom, it changes to these unruly, no good. They call you everything in the book. And but just as far as the atmosphere and staying in the game and trying to take you out of your game, Wrigley by far, to me, was the best.
Man, don't you know who I am? I mean,
majority of my career, it was Jimmy Leland. I just had that sense, you know, that he knew it a little bit better than everybody else. But now, going out the door, you know, those other three guys, La Russa's there, Boach is there, Dusty's there. There's probably a couple other guys who'd be in that same class there shortly. But, you know, those three guys, to me, are right there where Jimmy Leland was in my mind. Vin Scully is, I grew up with Vin Scully, and it was hard because he was, you know, he does the Dodger games, and Padre Dodger, you know, it's not supposed to be, you know, but yeah, Vin Scully was my favorite announcer growing up, and he's the only broadcaster I ever asked to sign a baseball for me, so yeah, I have that one in my trophy case, so that's a very special ball. Turk Wendell, when he first came up with the Cubs, had this thing where he chewed black licorice and then hopped over the mound and then went to the dugout, brushed his teeth, spit it all out, and then put it back in before he went to pitch again. And I to see that firsthand, you know, he that was the weirdest one I saw. But that's how the game is. Sometimes guys are like that, you know. They don't believe that they're going to be able to have success unless they do certain things. But I can say this with certainty. It ain't going to be like that here at State. No black licorice, no brushing your teeth in between innings. You know, if there was an award given for the best gift that I got after I announced my retirement, that would be very difficult because I got some really great gifts. And to me, the best part of all of that is not so much the gifts, it's the memories that were created on those particular days. Like in Milwaukee, having Davey Lopes give me a Harley Davidson jacket, I love that. And little did I know later on I would get a Harley Davidson to go along with it. And so a lot of the gifts were very special. And some of them you can't wear. You know, we had to put it in a trophy case. And like the belt buckle they gave me in Houston, that was class. And so I think Karen Slayton's going to help us out describing some of this stuff. So go ahead, Karen.
Tony Gwynn remembers the first moment he realized 2001 would be his last season.
And Tony Gwynn will pinch hit.
And it was the year 2000. We're in Cincinnati. And we're on AstroTurf, so Boch doesn't want to play me, you know. And I'm sitting on the bench, and it's tie game in the 10th inning. I'm leading off the 10th inning. I'm pinch hitting in the 10th inning. And Scott Williamson is pitching. And he's throwing cheese. He's throwing hard. And he throws a fastball in, and to this day, I still don't know how I got to it. And I hit it down the line for a double.
Right field line, into the corner it goes, and that's in there. Tony Gwynn heading to second base with a double.
And I'm rounded first, and I'm going into second, and I mean, I'm going as hard as I can go, and I'm not getting anywhere.
Corey DeHaan will run for him as Tony limps off the field.
And that night, I knew I needed surgery.
Can't run, but he can still swing that bat.
And it's kind of disgusting watching the way I tried to jog off the field that night. And I sat down on a bench, and Sonny Jaramillo, or the guy who was traveling with us to collect all this 3,000 hit stuff, I'm sitting next to him, and I said, "You know what, Sonny, that might be the last hit I ever get right there." And he said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Man, my knee is killing me. That might be it." And that was the moment where I decided I was going to have surgery. I was going to try to come back and play one more year, but it was going to be my last year.
Tony kept that news a secret until word leaked out. That led to a press conference June 28th of 2001.
Well, today I have to make it official, and this will be my last year playing with the Padres. I've had a great time. It's been a wonderful experience, but I'm not dying today. You know, I mean, people have been talking about like it's, you know, I have nothing else to offer. I've loved baseball. I've played this game for a long time, and I've had a ball, but it's just time to start thinking about doing something else.
His announcement triggered honors at every road stop the rest of the season, beginning in Houston.
Astros owner Drayton McLean is now on the field to present a couple of hometown Houston gifts to Tony Gwynn. The first is a custom-made sterling silver and gold belt buckle from the Max Lang Company. The buckle is inscribed with Tony's number 19 and reflects his 20 major league seasons as a member of the San Diego Padres. The second is unique to Houston from our friends at the Johnson Space Center, featuring a Texas flag that has been flown in space on board the space shuttle Discovery.
A special commemorative Tony Gwynn model bat signed by the entire 2001 Florida Marlins team. This bat was specially produced by Louisville Slugger just for this occasion.
Today, the Rockies organization would like to take this opportunity to present a special portrait of Tony. This portrait shows Tony in a pose we will never forget, putting the bat on the ball.
In Arizona, the eventual World Series champs, many former teammates joined Tony on the field. In St. Louis, a gathering of Hall of Famers and Cardinal legends honored a future Hall of Famer.
Bob Gibson, Lou Brock, Ozzie Smith, you know, Stan Musial would have been there. Red Shandings was there. You know, and as it turns out, Mark McGwire was there, and now he's decided he's going to retire.
Jim Riggleman.
In Los Angeles, it was another gathering of former Padres.
3 o'clock in the afternoon, all by himself with only a batting practice pitcher, he would hit ball after ball after ball because he knew that God had blessed him with a certain amount of ability. And that if he worked hard and he kept practicing and the repetition of hitting, which is the single most difficult skill in all of sports, that maybe one day he would be the best hitter in the game. And year after year, he has gone out and nobody has been more consistent. Nobody has been more dedicated. Nobody has given back to this game more on and off the field than Tony Gwynn. And there's an old saying that he has been good for so long that he has become great. And it's my pleasure to say that not only was he a teammate, but also a friend. And for all of you, you have a chance to see now and have over the years one of the greatest players to ever play the game.
The final road trip brought Tony to San Francisco. Tony, how does it feel to be on your last road trip?
Actually, it feels really good. This is the last speech I got to make on the road. It's the last hotel I got to stay in for a while. It's the last plane flight I have to take for a while. And honestly, I feel really good about it myself. I'm calm. I'm under control. The road is kind of easy in the sense that, you know, a lot of people are appreciative of what you've done, but they don't really know you, you know. And the people at home, they really know you. So you know, I'm fine today, but I think when I get on this plane and go home and I get in my truck and I drive home, I'm sure I'll be thinking about the next Sunday, which is really going to be really tough.
The final ceremony on the road would have marked Tony's last game, if not for the schedule changes brought on by the tragedies of September 11th. On his day in San Francisco, Tony deflected some of the attention.
To congratulate Eric Davis, because he's retiring this year too. And this man has had one heck of a career, and there are a lot of other guys in this game who've had heck of careers too and don't get to go through what Cal and I get to go through. So, Eric, you've had a wonderful career, and good luck to you.
I can see it in the coach's eyes. They're starting to get emotional. I can see it in my teammates' eyes. They're starting to get emotional. Guys on the other club starting to get emotional, and I was calm, you know, and that was what really surprised me, because I thought I'd just be breaking down big time, you know, and I was actually pretty good, and I actually got to the point where I was looking forward to, you know, finishing up and going on about my business.
It was time to return to San Diego for his final 6 home games and even more emotional farewells.
So what am I doing now? Well, I'm a retired guy who spends a lot of time here at San Diego State teaching hitting, teaching outfield play. And I'm still a fan. I'm still a big sports fan, a big Charger fan. We'll be a big Padre fan this coming season. And hopefully there'll be baseball to be played, hopefully. But I'm doing really good. I'm doing all the things that I really wanted to do. I'm having a lot of fun doing it. It's time consuming, but all in all, it's exactly what I wanted to do, and so I couldn't be more thrilled to be in the situation that I'm in. We'd like to see all of you out there at Tony Gwynn Stadium. I can't believe I said that.
Hard to believe, but true. Tony Gwynn, who wrapped up his college baseball career in 1981, is back on the diamond at San Diego State. First as an unpaid assistant. At the end of the 2002 regular season, Tony takes over for the man who coached him, Jim Dietz.
I take more pride in having the title coach than I do having a stadium named after me, because, you know, that, I mean, I don't know, it could stay there forever. I don't know. That coach, you have to earn that one. And so I'm in the process of trying to earn that. And I think I'm doing okay. It's been fun.
There's business away from the diamond as well. Tony and his wife, Alicia, are involved in opening Church's Chicken franchises.
One open in Bakersfield, and we have another one will open up there, and then our first one here, and then one in Oceanside. And yeah, it is aggressive. And we've committed to opening 10, and we're going to open 10.
Tony's also involved with the Gwynn Curriculum Support Center. an after-school educational program founded by Alicia.
So this is along the x-axis, right?
Yeah. Here, students from Poway and surrounding school districts are tutored.
Let's face it, has been blessed in so many ways, if not through baseball, through other things. And, you know, we both love children, and, you know, we love to see each kid succeed at whatever they're doing. So we try to lend a hand in helping them get to the success level that they want.
The GCSC, as it is known, came about thanks to Maureen Rodman, who successfully tutored Anthony Gwynn from her home.
Mrs. Gwynn and I decided that it would be fun to service the area with inexpensive, affordable tutoring support for as many students as we could possibly handle.
The Curriculum Center not only aids local schools, it provides jobs. 50 college and high schoolers tutor more than 200 pupils, so it's students helping students.
They're more my age, so I can relate better to them, and I don't know, they just seem like normal kids like me.
So you're going to take these points?
There's a lot of temptations to slip away from the academic world, and when they see other kids, their peers who are a little older, that are still involved in studying in school, it's motivating for them to see that it's still cool to do well in grades in school.
With businesses, charity work, and baseball, is this really retirement?
I think people think we're supposed to just sit around and watch football games and on Sunday and watch basketball games and not do anything, you know, and I can't do it. You know, I can't survive that way. I have to try to stay busy and try to stay involved in doing things that are important to me and important to my family.
Did you take your stride?
Well, that'll do it. And once again, before I go, I'd like to thank all of our fans in Baja California and San Diego County. Thank my family and friends for being very supportive. And I'd like to thank the San Diego Padres for letting me use their community relations staff and PR staff to help me do some of the things that we've been able to do here in the last 20 years. So once again, as I've said many times before, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Throughout these years, I've watched you grow.
San Diego icon, and you always will be.
I was a fan of yours when I was a kid, if that dates you, but it was an honor competing against you. You're truly a professional and helped the fans of San Diego appreciate what they had over the last two decades. Good luck to you.
Now, as a manager, I'm thankful for so many things you did for me, not just the clutch hits and the great play, but what you did in the clubhouse and the leadership that you provided.
Congratulations. It's been great. We got a chance to watch you play, be on the same field. It was an honor. Enjoy life after baseball, but you got to come visit because, you know, guys like us still want you to come around and say hi to us because we are going to miss you.
When I think of you, I think of how easy you made hitting look.
I wish that I had a chance to see it more in person, but I'm very thankful for the small times that I did get a chance to see that. You made a tremendous mark on baseball. You should be proud of that.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today is the last day of the baseball year 2001. Today is the last day of one of the greatest players in the last 100 years of baseball, Tony Gwynn. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to a man invited by Tony and the San Diego Padres, who many consider to be the greatest broadcaster in the country today, Mr. Bob Costas.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, folks. This baseball canopy back here works for me. Good luck to Dave Winfield making his way through it. As Jerry said, we reached the end of a great baseball season, and what a weekend, just this weekend. Barry Bonds, Cal Ripken, Ricky Henderson with his 3,000th here earlier today. And now, farewell to Tony Gwynn. So let me take you back to 1969, the birth of this franchise. While a 9-year-old was growing up in Long Beach, the Padres of those early days may have been short on wins, but they weren't without their heroes. A slugger started launching home runs in 1969, and he didn't stop until he'd set a record that he still holds to this day. Here's the Padres' all-time home run leader, Nate Colbert. Padre fans also fell in love with the outstanding left-hander of those times, the club's first 20-game winner, and the man who would win the Padres' first ever Cy Young Award. His name, Randy Jones. Joining Randy was the extraordinary outfielder from the University of Minnesota, who went straight to the majors to begin a career that would lead him to Cooperstown. One of the best all-round players of his time, welcome Hall of Famer, Dave Winfield. But as the 1970s gave way to the 80s, Nate was gone, Randy was gone, Dave was gone. San Diego was ready for a new baseball hero. On July 19th, 1982, he made his Padres debut. His childhood sweetheart was with him then, as she is now. Ladies and gentlemen, Tony and Alicia Gwynn. Tony, we have a special message for you received earlier today. It reads this way. To Tony Gwynn, you have long been one of my heroes. No one has ever exceeded you in personifying the finest aspects of baseball and competitive sports. Rosalind and I wish you a wonderful and successful retirement as you move on to other great accomplishments. With gratitude and best wishes, former President Jimmy Carter. Tony, you'd only spent a year in the minors, a testament to the preparation for professional baseball that you received at San Diego State University under your coach, the man whom you will now succeed as the Aztecs baseball coach. Here's Jim Dietz. And let's be sure to give credit where credit is due to the two men who decided to select you, to sign you, and to launch your professional career. Please welcome Director of Scouting Bob Fontaine and General Manager Jack McKean. And so, by July 19th of 1982, you were ready to make your major league debut. And when you took the field that night, starting out there in center, this is what the scene looked like. This is what it sounded like when longtime PA announcer John DeMott introduced you and your teammates, Tony, in his trademark style. Here's John DeMott.
And now, here are your 1982 Padres. Left field, Gene Richards. Center field, Anthony Gwynn. Right field, Sixto Lescano. Third base, Luis Salazar. Shortstop, Gene Templeton. Second base, Tim Flannery. First base, Broderick Perkins. Behind the plate, Terry Kennedy. And on the mound, left-hander John Curtis.
And Tony, as John DeMott said, just like that night in 1982, there's a Gwynn starting in center field tonight, along with Tony's original Padre teammates. In center tonight, that's young Anthony Gwynn. Tony, your first manager, was a tough baseball man with a gruff voice and an iron fist. He'd teach you how to play the game right. He was one of the best managers of his generation, and he's here tonight, Dick Williams. Padres were playing the Phillies that night, and a young left-hander named Sid Mangi became part of history by allowing the first of your 3,141 career base hits. Here's Sid Mangi. No embarrassment in that, Sid. You were far from alone. In fact, Greg Maddux gave up more than anybody, 38 of them over the years. You just got things started, that's all. 2 years later, San Diego basked in the glory of a championship season. Remember the year that a rookie from Little Rock, Arkansas had? He hit this opening night home run, and he wound up with 20 homers plus 75 runs driven in. And in Game 3 of the National League Championship Series, his three-run homer iced the Padres' first ever postseason win. Welcome back, Kevin McReynolds. And then setting the stage for the most memorable moment in the history of the Padres, it was you, Tony, in Game 4 of the National League Championship Series, who singled with one out in the bottom of the ninth. And that brought up Steve Garvey.
Now here's Steve Garvey, Gwynn at second. High and away, the count 1-0. Gwynn's at first, I should say. There's one out.
Sometimes when I'm in outfield and you get a hot hitter really having a great day, it seems like he hits every other inning.
Yeah, that's right. I swore they hit out of order at times. What are they doing back here again? Want to know the count. And, oh, a little slight feint. A little feint. Tony Gwynn, 33 stolen bases on the year.
Well, if Gwynn's thinking about going the way Smith bent that left leg, that can be a tricky one. That's close to a balk move.
Deep right field. Way back. Cut a gone back to the wall. It's gone. Home run, Garvey. And there will be tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Garvey. And then the next day in Game 5, it was you again, Tony, with a decisive two-run double in the seventh inning that sent the Padres to their first ever World Series. What a year. While the Padres were winning their first National League championship, you were an All-Star for the first time, and you won your first National League batting championship, symbolized by your first silver bat. So here, symbolically, a World Series ring number one, All-Star ring number one, and silver bat number one. In 1985, the uniforms mercifully changed to pinstripes, albeit brown, but you didn't change, except to get even better. You were an All-Star again in 1985. Here's All-Star ring number two. You better have an awfully big trophy room at home. Well, the hits kept coming, the smiles kept coming, the infectious laugh kept coming, and your second child was born that year, your daughter, Anisha. Here's Anisha. Your well-known hard work and dedication were paying off for you when in 1986, as an All-Star for the third time, you won your first Rawlings Gold Glove Award. So here's All-Star ring number three and Gold Glove number one. through hard work and dedication, you'd become the best at your defensive position. And a rookie joined the team that year, someone you knew from your first year in pro ball, 1981 at Walla Walla, Washington. He's grateful to this day for all you taught him along the way. Welcome back, John Kruk, who's accompanied by his manager from Walla Walla, Bill Brock. Man, for Kruk, that's formal attire. Well, Tony, you reached new heights in 1987 when your 370 batting average was the highest in the National League in nearly 40 years. And it was your fourth All-Star performance, your second Rawlings Gold Glove, and your second silver bat as the National League batting titleist. When 1988 rolled around, you delivered your 1,000th career hit, and it came off the legendary Nolan Ryan. You were on your way to winning your third silver bat. Bring it on out. Then in 1989, it was your third Gold Glove, your fifth All-Star game, and in a memorable head-to-head competition against San Francisco's Will Clark, you knocked six hits in your last eight at-bats to win your fourth silver bat. What a pennant race that year, too, and a big reason why the Padres were in it was the stellar season of a sensational closer. He saved 44 games while winning the Cy Young Award. Here he is, Mark Davis. Change was in store in 1990. New owners would take over the club, and the pinstripes would change from brown to blue. And could anybody know just how ironic it would later seem, as your 1,500th hit was a single in August against Montreal? You were the definition of excellence and consistency, a Rawlings Gold Glove winner for the fourth time, and an All-Star for the sixth. The same in 1991. A Rawlings Gold Glove for the fifth time and an All-Star berth for the seventh time. More in 1992 when you were an All-Star for the eighth time. And again in 1993, an All-Star berth for the ninth time. And 1993 brought another August milestone. It was hit number 2,000.
The 1-1 on away, bounding ball, there it is. Base hit left center field, number 2,000.
That was an August 6th birthday gift for your proud mom. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Mrs. Vendela Gwynn. On to 1994. You couldn't possibly be getting better, could you? In a season that was cut short, you hit 394. And might have surged past 400 if the season had been played to its completion. Still, it was the best mark since 406 in 1941 by San Diego's own Ted Williams, who was about to become a major influence on you, as if you needed the help. During that 94 season, you had your 10th All-Star appearance, and in that game in Pittsburgh, you raced around from first base to score the winning run in extra innings to give the National League its first win in 7 years.
swinging a drive into the gap in left center field. And up against the fence. This could do it. Being waved home is Gwynn. They got a play to Rodriguez. Safe! Safe! And the six-game drought is over for the National League.
And of course, for that .394 batting average, you won a richly deserved fifth silver bat. That one was for hitting .394. That's the highest batting average in the big leagues in the last 60 years. Change came again in 1995 for the Padres, where you had remained while others had departed. It was the dawn of a new era, led by the generosity of John Moores and his family. Here they are. An old teammate was now your new manager. And of course, he's still the Padres skipper. Here he is, Bruce Bochy. And as ever, you earned another trip to the All-Star game, your 11th, and you won your sixth silver bat. The 1996 Padres were a talented bunch, and the team returned to glory. Meanwhile, you were an All-Star for the 12th time, and you hit .353 to win silver bat number 7. And while you achieved yet another August milestone, hit number 2,500, your sweetest hit came in the second to last game of the season.
A 2-2 game, top of the eighth. To the left side and through. Reed scores. Here comes Vaughn. It's a two-run single and a 4-2 Padre lead.
With that hit, Tony Gwynn possibly could put the Padres into the playoffs and win the batting title with one swing.
Perhaps only one thing could top that thrill. Only one thing could be better than knocking in the runs to send the Padres to the playoffs, and that would be seeing some of the glory go to your kid brother, Chris Gwynn. There he stood in the 11th inning of a scoreless game, the last day of the season in Los Angeles. The Padres and Dodgers in a dead heat. The winner would be the champion of the National League West.
Padres have runners at first and third, nobody out, 11th inning. Game on the line. Gwynn, the man of the moment. That's it. Base hit. Big base hit. Here's one run coming in. Here's another run coming in. Padres two. Dodgers nothing. Woo!
The Padres were champs thanks to two Gwynns. And here is Chris Gwynn. In your 16th year, Tony, you were still getting better. Incorporating Ted Williams' wisdom and working relentlessly, you complemented a .372 batting average with 17 home runs and 119 RBIs. You were an All-Star for the 13th time and the winner of a silver bat for an incredible 8th time, matching Hannes Wagner's National League record. No one in the history of the National League has ever won more, and only Ty Cobb won more in the American League. And now on to 1998. another Padres high point. Once again, supported by an outstanding closer on the mound. Here's Trevor Hoffman. And how about the catcher on that team? Part of the soul and inspiration of that pennant winner. Welcome back, Carlos Hernandez. And in that pennant-winning season of 1998, Tony, you were an All-Star for the 14th time. You hit .321 to help lead the Cub to another National League West title as you bested the arch-rival Dodgers. Here's All-Star ring number 14.
Struck him out, and the Padres have done it. The Padres win as the 1998 National League Western Division champions.
Then came a terrific division series against Houston.
Oh, he's over the head of Biggio.
Tony Gwynn at his best right there. I mean, I don't know how a left-hander can hit this pitch.
The Padres, an out away, a strike away of going to the National League Championship Series for the first time since 84. On the ground, Barris throws, and the Padres will march to Atlanta.
Next, a big LCS against Atlanta with the Padres winning in six to claim the pennant.
Stretch by Smoltz, and the pitch to Gwynn, lined into left center field. That's going to get in. They're going to wave Hernandez home. Barris to third. Gwynn does it again. A two-out single, and we're tied at one apiece. To say that he can hit is like saying the Grand Canyon is a hole in the ground. But he can hit.
Gwynn pulls it into right center field. Tucker won't get it. Digging for third is Barris. They're going to bring him to the plate. 1-0 San Diego.
Tony Gwynn using that 5.5 hole, the area between the third baseman and the shortstop. That's where this man has made his living for 17 years, right there.
Drive left center field in the air, coming off quickly, Finley, he's under, he's got it, and the Padres draped the National League flag around their shoulders for 1998. Ho ho, doctor!
That meant a return to the World Series and your first ever visit to historic Yankee Stadium.
Deep right field, that's fair, it's gone, and it is going and gone. Home run, Anthony Keith Gwynn, 4-2 Padres.
The conclusion of that season brought plenty of emotion, appreciation, and gratitude as much as anything else.
With over 65,000 on hand and their team losing, they've stayed. And the San Diego Padre players who went into the clubhouse have come back out. Juwale Joyner is out there by the pitching mound now. Tony Gwynn came out a minute ago. Trevor Hoffman came out.
Well, I think it's a chance for the Padre fans to say thank you to their ball club for the effort they gave in this series and all season long.
another World Series ring is put in place. By 1999, we were counting down. And no one should have been surprised when that season's biggest milestone came again in August, again in Montreal, again on your mother's birthday.
Line drive, center field, there it is, number 3,000 for Tony Gwynn.
Oh, doctor, you can hang a star on that, baby. A star for the ages for Tony Gwynn, number 3,000.
Hasta Canadá se escribe la historia, el hit 3,000 de Tony Gwynn.
Michigan, Michigan, 3,000 cousins.
Well, you were an all-star for the 15th time, and your place in Cooperstown was etched in bronze. Here's all-star ring number 15. The next year, 2000, you hit 323 for an amazing 18th straight season over 300. And now here we are in 2001, and you've once more joined the All-Stars 16 times for you, and once again, you've hit over 300. Appropriately for you, that's 19 times. And here's All-Star ring number 16. Tony, you've earned the admiration and respect of all your teammates through the years, and now the ones with whom you're completing your magnificent career will come out to bid you goodbye. Here they are, the 2001 Padres. By the way, when Ricky Henderson got his 3,000th hit in the season's final game, it marked the first time in National League history that teammates had 3,000 hits. And now, speaking on behalf of the entire Padre ball club, a guy who had a great season, three homers yesterday, including a grand slam, here's Phil Nevin.
See, I think it goes without saying you've had a pretty amazing career. But to see the impact and the influence you have on so many people in San Diego, it's unreal. But I don't think any of these people realize the impact you have on all of us that you deal with every day. You just, it's plain and simple, you just make everyone better. And we, as a team, trying to think of something to give you. And I remember this year in Milwaukee, you got a jacket. Well, you got something to go with the jacket. I made sure I asked Alicia if it was okay, and she gave me the all right.
Tony, if it's true that baseball has marked the time in America, then you have marked the time for two decades in San Diego.
All in all, I think I did okay.
Okay? You were a lot better than okay, Tony. You were the greatest player in the history of the Padres, the greatest pure hitter of our time, and San Diego's most accomplished sports star. Padre fans will never forget all the great moments, and now we understand you have mementos and artifacts that you want to share with your fans. San Diego Mayor Dick Murphy will now receive them from you, and they'll begin a community-wide tour starting at City Hall. They'll also be on display at schools and libraries for children to see and touch. Tony, that community spirit is a big part of San Diego's love for you. And while your playing career ends today, the connection will endure. For generations, people will tell the stories of the man whose number and name will become the official address of the Padres' new home. The new ballpark will be located at number 19, Tony Gwynn Drive. From a city and a baseball nation that admires and respects who you are and what you represent, please accept our gratitude and once again our cheers. We thank you and congratulations, Tony. I've been lucky enough to have a good many thrills in sports and in baseball in particular. But it's one of my greatest honors to be able to say now, ladies and gentlemen, Tony Gwynn.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know, I thought I was prepared for today, but I got to tell you, I am in shock. I am in shock. This motorcycle is sharp. This is just the thing a guy getting ready to have knee surgery should have him, a Harley Davidson. You know, it's been a wonderful trip. 20 years, all with the Padres. Bad uniforms and good uniforms. You know what, the best thing about it, though, was my teammates. You know, seeing all these guys here tonight. Dick Williams, Jack McCann were the two guys that I started to pay attention when it came to play baseball. Because if you didn't, you wouldn't play. Pure and simple. So you had to pay attention. And Broderick Perkins, who's sitting over here, one of his lines was, keep your eyes and ears open and your mouth shut. And he was right. Because I learned a lot, and I learned a lot quickly. And the reason that I get off to such a good start in my career is because of guys like these. Terry Kennedy, John Curtis, Gary Templeton, Gene Richards, Louis Salazar, Sixto Lescano, Gary Templeton, Tim Flannery, all these guys, they were the guys that taught me how to play the game. And they didn't have to do that. You know, the game has changed a lot. When I came up, a lot of times a guy like me would come up and guys who were already in the big leagues, a lot of times felt like I was trying to steal their job. And they were right, I was. But all these guys here kept feeding me information. They kept feeding me information. And in the course of getting all this information, I started to realize that that's how you get better in this game, is by listening to people who have played the game before us. And it's a valuable lesson, especially for those kids, you kids sitting out there who dream one day of standing here where I'm standing, where I'm your example. I'm the example of a guy, excuse me, who has worked hard and had some success. Never did I dream I would have the kind of success that I've had. But the lessons that I learned early, I've tried to emulate as I've gotten older and I played longer. These guys standing back here in these blue uniforms, you should be so proud of the way these guys have played the game. Best team in baseball. That's what they said in spring training. And Bruce Bochy called one of the best meetings I've ever seen in my 20 years. Gideon, was it Boch? Comes in, gives us this speech about Gideon and all these soldiers, and all these guys bought it. Every last one of us, we all bought it. And at the end of that meeting, we would have ran through a brick wall for Bruce Bochy. That's right, give it up, Bruce Bochy. See, Bruce Bochy was also a member of that team that was on when I came up in 82. And he learned from Dick Williams, because I can see his style in him. He learned from Jack McCann. I can see his style in him. And he's been here how long now, Bochy? 8 years? 8 years. 500 victories. He's done a heck of a job. But see, that's what the game is all about. The game is all about taking in the information, practicing, and then executing. And that's it. It's pure and simple. We make it difficult because our heads get in the way. Right, guys? Right? We make it difficult because we think about it. But without guys willing to share that information, this game wouldn't be what it is. You know, you guys had a chance today to witness some history. Some history that I was hoping that I would be the guy getting my 3,000th hit here, but I wasn't. And Ricky Henderson was. Man, what a sight. Ricky cruising into second base and all of his teammates running out there. I mean, that's what the game is all about. Here's a guy who's played 23 years. He's the all-time leader in steals, in walks, in runs scored. And today, on October 7th, 2001, he steps up to the plate and he gets it done. And I am so proud of you, Ricky. I'm really happy for you. See, us old guys, we still got a little something. You know, the next two guys, I would be remiss if I left here without mentioning their two names. Phil Nevin and Ryan Klesko. Come on. Come on out here. Tip your cap. How about the year these two guys have had? Huh? Forty homers, 30 homers. He hits the ball out the other way. He steals bases. But you know what the best thing about both of them are? They're leaders. They lead these young guys. They tell them what to do, where to go, and that's the really important part, as far as I'm concerned. They go out there on the field, they lead by example. These young guys, they follow. That's what baseball is all about. Thank you. You guys. I heard that. Somebody yelled, "You better not leave us, Phil. We can't let him go." And last and not least, on our ball club, this guy has been solid as a rock for 8 years, 9 years. You guys know them when they ring those bells out there in the ninth inning. But once again, you know, we know what he does on the field. And us guys who are wearing the blue jerseys, we know what he does in the clubhouse. We know what he does when he's out here running in his Dr. Schmuck out here in the outfield every day. You know, he's a leader. He's leading by example. He's taking these young guys by the hands and saying, "Hey, guys, this is how we do it." And these guys follow. That's why I have no doubt this is going to be a quality organization for a long time to come. Mr. Trevor Hoffman. okay. I guess I'm supposed to talk about me now, huh? You know, 20 years. I think you guys have heard all the stories. I don't think there's any other stories I can tell you. I think it's important that before I leave here tonight, that I let each and every one of you people here tonight know how important you guys are in our lives. Because you're the ones that allow us to come out here and do what we do. Without you, we can't do what we do. And you guys have been unbelievable for 20 years. And I'm going to say thank you. I think everybody sitting here is going to say thank you, because I just can't even explain it. It's unbelievable. Your support has been unbelievable. And we thank you. Thank you. I can't do all of this by myself. I mean, I do what I do on the field, but I can't do what I do without a partner, without somebody to share the experience with. And my wife, Alicia, has been there the whole way, and I love you. You know, Mom, you know, I've been fortunate enough to get 2,000 on your birthday. Get 3,000 on your birthday. I'm sorry, I'm going to retire closer to Chris's birthday, but you know, my upbringing with you and Dad, there's just no way that I could have turned out the way that I did without you, y'all spanking some behind and telling us right and wrong, teaching us how to be men. And if my father was here today, I think he'd be very proud. I think he'd be proud. Thank you. I think he would be proud of his three sons, because, you know, we're raising a family ourselves. And, you know, I just think he would be proud that his sons had grown up and were able to take care of themselves. And my older brother is here too today, and I want to bring him out. Charles, come on out. My older brother, Charles. You know, my older brother, Charles, he was the one who led the way. He was the first one to try out for Little League while Chris and I stayed in the house. We were scared. We didn't want to try out, but he did. He led the way, and we just kind of followed his example. And, yeah, exactly. Thank you, Charles. We appreciate it. You know, it's been unbelievable. Never in my wildest dreams did I think I'd be standing here after 20 years, you know, really feeling good about a decision that I made about a year and a half ago. But honestly, I do. I feel good that I've done all I can do as a baseball player. And like my older brother now, he's a teacher, has been a teacher for 20 years, and now it's my turn to teach. So I love you too. Thank you. So I hope that in the near future, when baseball season comes around again, and you need that Tony Gwynn fix, you know, that fix where you want to just see somebody laughing and having a good time doing what he's doing, and you come out to the Padre games, because I want you to come out to the Padre games. But they're going to be out of town sometimes. And there's a park just about 5 minutes over the hill. Yeah, the parking's tough, but the game is really exciting. I hope that everyone here at some point will come on out and give us a look and be a supporter for us over there as you've been for us over here. Once again, God bless all of you. I thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.